The ACT Party has pitched a new funding method for the extreme weather rebuild as part of its 15-point recovery plan. Party leader David Seymour is with us for the first time in 2023. Kia ora, good morning.
Good morning.
How should we pay for the damage?
Well, there's three basic options. One is tax people more and harder. Two is borrow and tax tomorrow's taxpayers. And three is to look really hard at the government's books and reduce expenditure. And that's what people are already having to do in a cost of living crisis. If they have their tyres fail a warrant, they've got to save for a couple of weeks until they balance their budget again. That's the situation that the government's in. In our plan, we've produced 15 ideas, but they start with the idea that we cannot afford to have another borrow and spend disaster recovery. We did that after COVID. We're now seeing the inflation. ACT's alternative budget released last May shows how it's possible for the government to reduce expenditure by $6.8 billion this year, $9.5 billion next year, and that is without touching any frontline health, education or police. That is, for example, reducing the number of public servants in Wellington back to 2017 levels. That would save you $900 million straight away.
OK, you've got a 15-point plan. We don't have time to go through all 15 points, but I do want to pick up on a couple of them. It's always good to have policy. So you've called for suspending fair pay agreements and minimum wage increases for 3 years within Hawke's Bay and Tairāwhiti in a special economic zone. How would that special economic zone work?
Well, look, I think parties, you know, need to point out when the government is wrong, but also have fresh new ideas for what it could be doing right. So the special economic zone, and you give two examples of 15 things that could be done. Right now, a lot of people are facing a lot of reform from the government. In fact, Chris Hipkins himself has said that the government's been trying to go too fast. So we say three waters. We think it's a bad idea anyway, but it should stop so councils can focus on their infrastructure.
Right. But that special economic zone, how would that work?
Yeah. So in the two areas of Tairāwhiti and Hawke's Bay, a range of current red tape and regulation would be suspended for the time being so people can get on with it. So we're talking about the Resource Management Act, we're talking about fair pay agreement, we're talking about the continual increases in the minimum wage that have put a lot of pressure on businesses. So I'll give you an example of an orchard. You know, they're going to have to plough their trees into the ground and they're going to take 4 years before the trees bear fruit again. It's already touch and go if they'll be able to afford to do that. But if the current minimum wage increase rate were carried on for the next 3 years, then by the time they get any fruit, they're up to $26 an hour. They just won't be able to do it. So it's all about government getting out of the way, listening to local people and empowering locals to rebuild what they had in a smarter way this time.
So if I'm a worker, why would I go and work there? I say, right, I don't have fair pay agreements. I don't have the minimum wage that I'm going to receive in other regions around New Zealand. We already know that there's a significant housing shortage. How's that going to work?
Well, what you've got to remember is that the minimum wage is not setting the wages for New Zealand. Wages are still set by agreements between employers and employees. What we're saying is that we should remove
those. But why else would you, why would you remove that barrier if you weren't allowing some employers to pay a lower rate than the minimum wage in other parts of New Zealand?
We'll put it this way. Maybe you're right, and no one's going to work in Hawke's Bay for less than $26 an hour. That's okay.
We leave them. Why would a worker be incentivised? I know you think a lot about incentives. But what would be the incentive if I was a worker to go to a region that doesn't have as good protections and has a lower minimum wage?
Put it the other way, maybe people want to do it anyway and maybe they won't go because there's too much bureaucracy and the minimum wage is too high for jobs to be offered in the first place. So if I'm right about that, leaving the minimum wage low, getting fair pay agreements off the table for the foreseeable future, that will help people do the work they need to rebuild. Now, of course, you know, if you're wrong and you put those restrictions in place and people don't go, you're adding costs to the rebuild. And remember, the more the rebuild costs, the more resources it drags in, the more government borrowing, the more money sloshing around in the economy, the more inflation that's going to put pressure on the cost of living, not just in Hawke's Bay and Tairāwhiti, but actually for New Zealanders
everywhere,
up and down the country who are under huge pressure to meet their bills each week already as it is.
So you've called for, quote, a replacement of council building consent processes with private insurance so that people don't need to wait for council consents if an insurer is prepared to insure the building. You know that insurance contracts only last a year.
Well, that's the way it works right now. But what we've proposed for a very long time is that instead of having council consents, you have to have mandatory insurance on new builds. That way, an insurance company is working out, well, you know, maybe this risk's worth it, maybe it's not. And I think it's become a more relevant policy after these disasters, because what we've seen is that often councils haven't made the right calculation. What's more, if we start having councils or central government bailing people out, the only way they're going to respond is the same way they responded after leaky buildings. they will put more stringent bureaucracy and requirements on people who want to build, because they're on the hook. If we make it a regulation that you have to have private insurance, a private insurer has an incentive to weigh up the costs and benefits in a way that councils don't.
But you can't mandate that they offer insurance for longer than a year, though, can you?
Well, if they want to participate in this scheme, that's what they'd be required to do.
Right, so any new insurance that you would mandate here in this space for any new build, you would say, right, that you have to offer insurance for more than a one-year contract.
Yeah, that's right. And I think you'll find that there are actually insurers that want to meet that market. We've been developing this policy over about 6 years, and we've had numerous discussions over that time. And the question is this: do you want another expansion of bureaucracy? You know, do you want more people asking, is Aotearoa the land of the long red tape? Do you want it to be more expensive to build? Do you want to lock a generation out of home ownership the way that they currently feel? Or do you want to start using fresh and practical ideas to try and make sure that people can solve the problems they have, rebuild their homes, their families and their businesses without getting beaten down by more big government?
I want to ask you a question I asked James Shaw regarding people whose homes have been destroyed by the weather events of this year and don't have insurance. Of course, insurance generally covers the cost of rebuilding a property, but it doesn't cover the land value. Should people who don't have insurance be bailed out for their land value if it doesn't make sense to rebuild?
Well, if the government is going to bail people out for their land value, then yes, I think the land is not insured in either instance, so that's not really the differentiator. On the other hand, the question is, should the government be bailing people out for the land? And, you know, if you focus on those people who are very hard up and your heart goes out to them, and I've visited some of them, then it's easy to say yes, absolutely. But you've also got to think about all New Zealanders in the long term. If there's an expectation that the government has to buy your land because it's guilty of not stopping you building, I tell you what the government's going to do, it's going to get really zealous about stopping people building. And again, I think about the long-term problem of young New Zealanders not seeing a ladder of opportunity into a property-owning democracy where they have a stake in this country. These decisions we make now are going to make that problem even harder if we get it wrong.
Has the cyclone and flooding event been a wake-up call for you?
Not at all. It's actually vindicated things that ACT has been saying for a long time. Number one, New Zealand's obsession with emissions reduction, which has been based on really just corporate welfare. I mean, they've got a $4.5 billion climate emergency response fund that's been going on things like emissions transport fund, freight decarbonisation grants, $15 million, renewable energy and public and Maori housing, $13 million, banning oil and gas, subsidising people to plant pine trees all over the East Coast, which hasn't turned out so well, unfortunately.
You know, let me ask about vindication. In 2016, you said, I believe climate change is real and a portion of it is man-made, but I question the extent to which it's dangerous. Do you think you've been vindicated on that comment?
Yeah, I do, because when I go and visit places like an orchard I was at in Napier just this weekend, or just this Thursday, what they showed me is that on the other side of the Tutaikuri River, in Taradale, the stop banks had been recently strengthened and they were fine. On their side, the stop banks were made from gravel and, funnily enough, the water washed the gravel away.
So you don't think climate change is dangerous?
They're now devastated. I think it's dangerous.
Well, in 2016, you, as party leader, said...
The extent to which it's dangerous, absolutely.
You still question the extent to which it's dangerous?
Yeah, I do, because all of these things are a balance. And I would say, you know, looking back
About those firefighters in Muriwai?
Well, looking back at your... Well, first of all, let's just ask, what is the
cause... I mean, would they question the extent to which it's dangerous?
Well, I'm sure that they would... first of all, let's just acknowledge their passing and their sacrifice.
But, I mean, you've played down the danger of climate change in a public leadership position.
Yeah, absolutely, because the question is, what's the extent of the danger of anything? It's not a case of this is our faith, this is our belief.
Pretty significant, any
and all measures are suitable. I'm interested in digging into the detail and getting practical. So I'll give you that example of Tutaikuri River in Napier.
Which had an inappropriate stop bank, as you say.
So,
I want to ask you more about this, though.
Well, let me give you another example.
No, let me give you an example. Okay. We've been through the archives, and I've got to say, it is remarkably easy to find explicit examples of your party disputing or downplaying climate change. Do you accept that the ACT Party has contributed to climate change denial?
No. What we've done is we've contributed to climate change understanding.
So when Rodney Hyde as party leader said, the entire climate change and global warming hypothesis is a hoax. How did he contribute to the understanding?
What year was that?
2008.
Okay, well, I was living in a separate country back then.
But he was your party leader. And yeah. I just asked if you accept that the ACT Party has contributed to climate change denial.
Yeah, well, I disagree with that statement, but I also point out that it's what, 15 years ago, if I'm going to be held to the standard of what each party said in 2008,
ACT Party policy that was on your website until 2016? Quote, New Zealand is not warming. If it were to warm moderately, we would likely benefit in terms of land-based production, human health and reduced heating bills. Arguments that we'd lose from sea level rise or more extreme events are unproven conjectures.
Well, I actually disagree with that statement.
Oh, it was on your party's website.
Well, I believe, again, how many years ago, but I believe that...
2016, yeah, until 2016.
I believe that New Zealand is
Were you
warming.
Party leader then?
I'm not. I wasn't aware of that statement. I don't know exactly what you're referring to.
It was actually.
It's certainly not a statement I've made.
It was a policy paper on your website until 2016.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I don't know who maintained that website at that time. That's another question. But can we talk about what I'm telling you today, which is that actually, if you want to judge me by the statements that I've made and what I've said, then actually I think
well,
we've
you said climate change isn't dangerous. That's what you said.
You
said you questioned the extent to which it was dangerous.
And I think that's healthy.
Okay. Your former party leader said the entire climate change and global warming hypothesis is a hoax.
15 years ago.
And the policy paper on your website until 2016 said New Zealand is not warming. So I'm going to go back to my question. Do you accept the ACT Party has contributed to climate change denial and inaction?
No, I don't. Again, you wanted to play this game of digging up 15-year-old statements. I'm not interested in that. What I'm interested in is what can New Zealand do practically now? What fresh new ideas do we need to solve this problem? I believe that ACT has the most robust and sensible climate policy on any party in New Zealand today, and that is that we cap our emissions under the emissions trading scheme in line with our trading partners. We adopt the same policy as the people we do business with around the world. Then we put our efforts into climate change adaptation. Again, an idea in this paper that we've championed for a long time is sharing more money with the councils that need to do the reconstruction.
Your party has presented lots of ideas. My question is, how does your party have any credibility on anything when it comes to climate change policy, given years of denial and inaction?
Well, if you actually look at what I've said and what I believe, then the credibility is very strong. If you want to dig up something on the Wayback Machine from a website a long time ago, then you can play that game. I don't think that helps. If we'd actually acted more then, if we'd taken it seriously then and taken greater steps,
we might not be in the position we find ourselves today.
And if you follow the policies that I have advocated, then we'd be in a much better space. And I think what you should be doing is asking, how is it credible that we have a Green Party who have had the climate change portfolio for 5 years? They're focused overwhelmingly on attempting emission reduction policies that haven't actually reduced emissions. Meanwhile, the rest of the world has continued emitting for the simple reason that you've got billions of impoverished people who will burn coal to avoid their children being malnourished. You know, I can understand that. So the question is, for New Zealanders, how do we practically contribute? And the example I would have liked to have given you before you went on your Wayback Machine tirade into history is I've just surveyed people in the Epsom electorate. You know, hundreds of people are writing about flooding that happened in their street. Half of them had previous drainage issues. A third of them had actually made a complaint to the council. So if you dig into it and get practical,
you're saying that adaptation makes sense and that too much of the focus has been on mitigation. I would look back and say actually there are just myriad examples where your party has contributed to downplaying the issue in a mitigation and adaptation sense.
And look, you want to live in the past, but I'm here in the present, having dug into the issues.
If only you've been in the present and the past. Am I right? If only you've been so future-focused a few years ago.
Actually, I always have been. You know, you're digging up something that was on a website, what, 7 years ago. Now, what I would say to you is that if the Green Party and the current government were governing for New Zealanders, not handing out corporate welfare to people for various emission reduction schemes that haven't worked, they would have been focused on the kind of practical adaptation focus that we have. The Green Party has failed in the most profound way. They are no longer radicals outside the tent throwing in truth bombs. They've been in the tent for a long time, and the truth is that they've made a major strategic error by focusing on ineffective emission reduction when ACT has a far more effective policy there today, and they've failed to focus on adaptation because of that $4.5 billion in the Climate Emergency Response Fund. In last year's budget, none of it went to an adaptation measure. That is the true failing, and that is why ACT has been vindicated as the credible party on climate change.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
ACT Party leader David Seymour.